Are cats taking over your mind? No, but for 60 million people around the world, they are changing the way you think.
What are you all afraid of? Cats, 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 cats.
You've probably heard cats are one of the major carriers of Toxoplasma gondii. The parasites live in cat droppings, but that's not the only place you can find them. You can also pick up these parasites by eating contaminated meat. According to the CDC, the problematic parasites usually reside in pork, venison, and lamb, although any undercooked meat could potentially carry them. You can also come into contact with these parasites in soil, on unwashed fruits and vegetables, or on food prepared in a kitchen in which cross-contamination occurs. It's also terrifyingly common. The CDC says around 60 million U.S. residents are living with this little hitchhiker, and researchers estimate about a third of the world's population is infected.
Okay, a little more than expected.
If you want to find out your own status with these parasites, there are tests that can detect them. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't know you caught them.
When you're first infected, you might come down with what feels like a bit of a cold.
That passes, after which your immune system keeps the parasites in line. They only start creating real havoc if your immune system is seriously compromised. If that happens, it'll attack your brain and eyes. At that point, you're in trouble. The parasite is estimated to kill as many people as malaria does.
Yeah, that's worse than I thought.
The story of how we discovered the parasite's powers is brilliant, and it's proof science happens in weird ways.
In the 1990s, a Czech scientist named Dr. Jaroslav Pfleger became convinced that there was a parasite living in his brain, influencing his personality and guiding his decisions.
Pfleger said his work began when he read a book on the flatworm, which invades the nervous systems of ants and paralyzes them to make them easy prey for sheep, the worm's final destination. Studying the impacts of these worms made him take a look at his own behavior, and he realized he was developing a tendency to do some nutty stuff. He reportedly noticed himself doing such things as walking into traffic, crossing busy streets without looking, and sharing political opinions that would have been better kept to himself. Gunfire didn't bother him either, and he realized that's not normal.
In 1990, he went to Charles University in Prague and joined an in-depth study into Toxoplasma gondii.
There, he was able to examine infected individuals and the parasite's life cycle. He realizes that essentially the only place the parasite can reproduce is inside a cat. Once it leaves the cat, it needs to get back in or die trying. Since humans aren't usually prey for cats, most of us are a dead-end host for these parasites. Or are we?
We don't have parasites!
By the time Pfleger got on board with studying Toxoplasma gondii, researchers had already discovered something weird about infected rats.
They were more active, less cautious, and more likely to wander into open spaces. Things got even weirder when an Imperial College London parasitologist introduced the scent of a cat to the research rats. She put infected rats into enclosures that had different areas treated with different scents: cat urine, rabbit urine, and the rat's own smell. The rats became so obsessed with a cat odor that researchers dubbed their condition fatal feline attraction. Next up for researchers were animals closer in the evolutionary chain than rats. In 2016, researchers in Gabon presented both infected and non-infected chimps with the smell of their natural predator, the leopard. Infected chimps were all about investigating the smell, while non-infected counterparts weren't so keen. But when scientists exposed infected subjects to the scents of lions and tigers, which are not their natural predators, there was no difference in their behavior. The conclusion was clear. The parasites modified the behavior of their hosts to make it more likely that they would get eaten by a cat. Another piece of the puzzle was provided by research from the National Institutes of Health in 2011. That's when researchers found that the presence of Toxoplasma in rats activated parts of the brain linked to sex. Instead of causing fear, the smell of cats turned the rats on.
Cats love this, trust me.
The parasite's influence on human behavior wasn't documented until 2002, when Dr. Pfleger found evidence that the parasite was modifying human behavior in similar ways to rats and chimpanzees. One behavioral difference he noticed in himself was his tendency to become oblivious to car horns. He also started crossing the street without looking. It's not surprising, then, that he found his first bit of evidence by analyzing traffic patterns. Infected drivers, he discovered, were around 2.6 times more likely to find themselves in a car accident. It was the first indication the parasite we thought was harmless and completely under our control was, in fact, affecting us, causing an increase in risky behavior. At first, it doesn't seem to make much sense. How could causing humans to take more risks be a part of a parasite's journey back into the bodies of cats?
According to Flegger, human beings were once a completely viable vehicle for getting toxoplasma back into cat host. And in some parts of the world, we still are. He suggests that thousands of years ago, big cats were a much bigger threat to humans in their day-to-day lives, and the parasite drove us into the mouths of lions or tigers. Flegger says he's found evidence in personality questionnaires he gives to infected and non-infected people, and says infected people are much less fearful of things like the forest or darkness. In other words, they're prime victims for big cats hunting at night. Flegger has also found Toxoplasma gondii doesn't change all human behavior in quite the same way. He claims that infected women were more likely to become more outgoing, friendly, and moral, though not more promiscuous. Infected men, on the other hand, became more guarded, more prone to jealousy, and more likely to break or bend the rules. Those reactions are pretty much polar opposites, but Flegger thinks he knows what's going on. He says it's possible the parasite is interacting with the way people react to chronic stress. Therefore, the opposite personality changes seen in infected people aren't that strange at all. Since men tend to withdraw during times of stress and women tend to reach out, the parasite may be putting the host under an extreme amount of stress. Those around them are just seeing the outward manifestations of that. The idea that we're not in control of our own emotions or behavior is a terrifying prospect, but more research suggests it's impossible to tell how it's going to impact us. Anne Catherine Stock from the University of Dresden puts it like this. It interferes with brain chemistry, but the parasite itself doesn't intend to harm someone. It always acts by the same mechanism. It's just that humans are very rarely prey to cats. That doesn't help its goal. And that means, at the end of the day, the effect of the parasite on humans is pretty scattershot. There have been links to an increased likelihood of the development of mental illness, but Stock's work also shows that there's a potential for some good changes as well. Her team found infected people had faster response times when they needed to react to changing stimuli.
Sir, I believe you owe this lady an apology.
Fry, no! He's bulging with what could be muscles.
There's also evidence that toxoplasma increases the amount of dopamine, the feel-good chemical in the brain. In rats, that's specific to the pathways that attract them to cats, but in humans, it's more complicated. The entire system gets flooded, and different people can have different reactions. Researchers have uncovered the process the parasite uses to infect humans, which to parasites are essentially an interim host. Melbourne scientists found that the parasite hijacks a healthy human cell to create a sort of bunker that provides it with everything it needs to survive in a dormant state. Toxoplasma releases proteins into the human cell, which then manipulates a person's chemistry to stockpile starches. Think of a bear hibernating for the winter. Fortunately, our immune systems keep on top of this sort of thing, at least in healthy individuals. Science is still working on figuring out some of the precise mechanisms, but they do know a healthy immune system will form cysts around the toxoplasma pockets. It's possible that increased levels of dopamine come because of the cyst and an increase in one particular enzyme that's key in both the development of the cyst and dopamine. What kind of impact the cyst has on the brain tissue around it isn't entirely clear. One of the things you may have heard about the Toxoplasma gondii parasite is it makes people more prone to mental illness, particularly schizophrenia. That's terrifying, but a 2016 study from Duke University looked at more than 1,000 people and found there was no link between infection and mental illness. Around 28% of their sample group, which was made up of people born in New Zealand in the early 1970s, were infected. Ultimately, it showed no correlation between infection and IQ, depression, schizophrenia, driving offenses, accident claims, or criminal convictions. Other studies, including one with a sample pool of 7,440 people, did not support a link between toxoplasma infection and mood disorders. University College London has also looked at the claim that when cats are present in the household of a pregnant woman or a child, the child is more susceptible to mental illness down the road. Good news for cat lovers. Across the 5,000-person sample pool, there was no link found between cat ownership and mental illness or impairments. It's undeniable that cats play a vital role in the life cycle of this weird parasite, but according to the CDC, there's absolutely no reason to give up your fluffy pet. They do recommend pregnant women stop cleaning the litter box, though.
Well, I was planning on doing that anyway.
They also say there's next to no chance of picking up the parasite by even petting an infected cat, as it's not transmitted by fur. All this is a great reason to keep your cats inside, as the CDC says they become infected by eating small animals that carry the parasite.
You'll be eating a fast food burger and boom! You'll be crawling with us again! Ever wonder what makes special sauce so special? Yo!
Keep cats inside and the problem is non-existent. And even if your cat's been outside before, you can still turn things around. Because the cat is part of Toxoplasma gondii's life cycle, they can only pass along the infection for about 2 weeks after becoming infected themselves. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more videos about messed up history are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.